So this is a very interesting and a very often asked question, which is to detect a loop, if there exists a loop in a singly linked list, right? So let's take a very simple example. Imagine I have a singly linked list like this, where my head pointer points to this, right? And let's assume I have a bunch of numbers like this. Okay, so let's assume this is my singly linked list, right? So your typical singly linked list, let's say, ends with a null pointer, right? The last node of your singly linked list points to a null, typically. And your head is a pointer pointing to the first node, typically. So now a loop in a singly linked list is when you have a structure like this, right? Instead of this pointing to null, imagine that this pointer points to some other node here, right? So now what do you have? You basically have node 2 and 3. And then is this nodes 4, 5, 6 form a loop here. This is what a loop means in a singly linked list. Okay. So the question here is to detect a loop if there exists a loop. Like for example, in this singly linked list, we have this loop, right? So we have 2, 3, then 4, 5, 6 are the nodes that are part of the loop, right? So our objective is to find this. Now let's think of a very, very simple way to solve this problem, right? Let's call this approach 1. It's a very simple approach, okay? Again, before you go into this approach, please pause this video for a few minutes and try to solve this problem using the data structures and algorithms that we already know of, right? So the simplest approach is, imagine, see, each of these nodes in my linked list has some address associated with it. Let's assume the address of this is 2000. The address of this is, let's say, 2200. The address of this is, let's say, 2400. The address of this is 2500. I'm just taking some numbers here for an example, right? So one thing that we could do here is we could store each of these. So the first approach, okay, it's a very simple approach, not a very great approach, but it's a simple approach. What it says here is as a traverse. So the first approach says, let's traverse the list, right? Let's traverse the list from the head node. And when I traverse the list, each of the nodes that I come across, I'll store the address of this node into a special data structure, which is typically like a hash table. Okay, I'll tell you why we will be storing it in a hash table, right? So I'll construct a hash table. Let's call this hash table H, right? Right. In this hash table, I'll start storing these addresses. Okay, so I'll first store the address 2000. Let me explain this solution of using a hash table to solve this problem. Okay. So first I encounter 2000. So I'll add 2000 to my hash table. Then I encounter 2200. The first thing I'll check is 2200 already present in my hash table? It is not present. So I'll add it. Now I'll go for 2400. Is 2400 already present in my hash table? No, it's not already present in my hash table. So I'll add it to my hash table. And remember, the time complexity to search if an element is present in a hash table, right? So the reason we are using a hash table here is the time complexity to search in a hash table is only order of 1, right? Similarly, the time complexity to add or to insert into a hash table, to add a new value or to insert a new value is also order of 1, right? Into a hash table. So we have already processed 2000, we have processed this node, we have processed this node. Next, I'll come to 2500, right? This node, which has a value of 5 and which has an address of 2500. Now, I'll check if 2500 is present. It's not present. So, if it's not present, I'll add it to this hash table, right? Remember, the time complexity to search and if it's present versus if it's not present to add it is order of 1 only. That's why we are using a hash table. If you take any other data structure here, instead of a hash table, the time complexity to search and to insert is not this low, right? Because hash table has this nice property, we are using that. Okay, very good. Next comes 2600, right? So now I check if 2600 is present. It's not present, so I'll add it. Now, what is the next node now? Because this pointer is pointing to 2400. The next node I'll search for is 2400 itself, is the node whose address is 2400. Now, when I search for 2400 here, right? When I search for this 2400 here, I will find this 2400 in my hash table. Now, what does that imply? That implies that somehow I've reached a node, which I've already visited once. Look at this. Only when I visited this node the first time, because it was not present in the hash table, I added it to the hash table. Now, if I'm revisiting the same node, which is stored at the same address, which means there is some loop in this singly linked list. That's why I'm able to revisit a node which I've already visited. So if I'm able to find any of these addresses, if I'm able to find in the hash table, I'll simply return and say that there is a loop. Right? Very simple solution, right? Again, here the key idea here is that I'm using a hash table here to search if there is a node that I've already visited or not. Similarly, and I'm doing all of that not using the values, because values can repeat. Look at this. Instead of 2, 3, 4, if I have 2, 2, 2, right? We should not be using the values that are there in the linked list, because values could repeat in a linked list, but the addresses won't repeat, right? In a proper linked list without a loop, the addresses won't repeat. So what I'm doing here is I'm traversing the singly linked list, right? And if I find an address which I'm revisiting, because I found it when I'm searching in the hash table, it implies that there's a loop. And when do you say there is no loop? If after traversing the whole list, if I reach a null, imagine this was not there. Imagine this was not there and this was pointing to null, right? So when I traverse a list from the head onwards, if I reach a null pointer, that means I've reached the end of the list and I've not seen any loops, right? That's one way to determine if there is no loop. And the way to determine and to ascertain and to be sure that there is a loop is if you are revisiting the same node again. Now, what is the total time and space complexity for this approach? Right, the total time complexity, if you think about it, whenever I'm visiting, so let's assume the length of the linked list itself is n. Right, so let's assume there are n nodes in my linked list. I'm visiting each node once, right? Whenever I visit each node, I search for it in the hash table. If it is not present, I add it. Since search and add to the hash table is order of one, the total time complexity is going to be order of n, because I'll be performing this search and insert on each of these nodes once, except for this duplicating node on which we'll perform one more operation, right? So the total time complexity is order of n. But what about the space complexity here, right? In this case, if you notice, in addition to using the order of n time, I'm also creating the hash table in which I'm storing all of this information, right? If I have to store n elements into a hash table, the total space complexity of the hash table itself is order of n, right? This solution, what do I have? I have order of n time complexity and order of n space complexity. And this order of n space complexity is because of the hash table, right? So while this solution is very good, it's a very simple solution, very elegant solution, using the hash table, but it is taking additional space. Now, the second approach, right, in a real world interview setup, if you actually provide this solution, the interviewer would ask you, can you somehow reduce the space complexity enough? It's very good that you have a good time complexity, but somehow can you come up with a methodology to reduce the space complexity from order of n? Sometimes an interviewer might also tell you that, can you reduce the space complexity to order of one? Okay, which means you can't use any interesting data structures like hash table anymore. Okay, so let's go to the second approach. Okay, which is wherein we are okay with the time complexity of order of n, right? But we want a space complexity. We want to improve on the space complexity, ideally to order of one. This is what we want to achieve now. Now, how do we do it? Okay, again, here, take a little pause. Pause this video and try to think of ways through which you can solve this problem. Okay, again, pause this video, spend a few minutes to think of ways in which you can reduce the space complexity to order of one. Okay, so I'm assuming that you have thought about this for a few minutes and you're back here. Okay, it's very, very important for you to think and ponder about these problems for a while. Okay, now back here. Now, solving this in order of n time and order of n space, there is a very popular algorithm called Floyd's cycle detection algorithm. Okay, so there is a very popular algorithm called as a Floyd's cycle detection algorithm, which actually solves this problem in order of n time and order of one space. It's a very elegant algorithm. Again, to be honest with you, when I was a student, when I was solving some of these algorithms problems, I couldn't come up with this algorithm on my own. Okay, I learned it because I struggled to solve this problem, I couldn't come up with it. So if you're not able to come up with this solution the very first time you're learning, or the first time you're seeing problems like this, it's okay. It's perfectly okay, right? So what this algorithm does is this. So this is also called as a hare and tortoise problem, a tortoise approach, right? So there are multiple names for this. I hope hare is basically like a rabbit, which runs fast, and a tortoise is something that runs slow. Okay, so this algorithm is also called as a hare and tortoise algorithm, or it's also called a fast, it's also called as a fast and slow pointer approach. Okay, so we'll stick to this terminology. It's also called as a Floyd cycle detection algorithm. The core idea is this. Okay, first let's look at the idea, then we'll see why the idea works. Okay, so let's assume this is my head pointer. Okay, so let's assume I have this bunch of numbers here. Let's say 2, 3, let's say 2, 4, let's say 6, right? And let's assume there is a loop here. Okay, let's assume there is a loop here. Now, what this algorithm says in a nutshell is this. Let's start with two pointers. I have two pointers. They're called fast pointer and a slow pointer. Okay, both of them initially will point to the head of the linked list itself. So what we do is the slow pointer in each iteration. Remember that in each iteration, right, a slow pointer moves by one step. Moves by one step. Right, that's why it's called a slow pointer, while the fast pointer moves by two steps. The fast pointer moves by two steps. Right, so it's a very interesting concept here. Right, so now let's look it up. Okay, so in iteration one, what happens? So we are starting here, right? This is where we start. Now I'll show you how this works first, and then I'll prove the correctness of this in a little while. And that's a fun part actually. Okay. Again, once you understand this concept of fast and slow pointers, you can employ this concept for many, many problems which are very similar to this. It's a cool idea. Okay? It's very hard to come up with this idea on your own the very first time when you're solving problems like this. But if you already know this concept once, it's very easy to solve problems like this, right? So in the first iteration, what happens is this. Okay? In the first iteration, my slow pointer and my when I start, my fast pointer is here, my slow pointer is here. In the first iteration, my slow pointer will move by one step. So my slow pointer will move here. It will no more be pointing to this. Right? Now my fast pointer will move by two steps in the same iteration. My slow pointer moved to the next node by one step. My fast pointer will move by two steps. Right? So let's look at it. So my fast pointer, since it's moving by two steps, one step, two steps. This is where my fast pointer will move. Okay? Next. In the next iteration, my slow pointer will move by one step. My fast pointer always moves by two steps. Okay. So now my slow pointer in the next iteration, my slow pointer will move here. Where my fast pointer will move to, because it is jumping by two steps, my fast pointer will move here. Okay. Now, in the next iteration, my slow pointer again moves by one step. We keep following these steps. Okay, this is where my slow pointer moves, right? And my fast pointer also moves by two steps now. So when I go to the next step, I go here, because this pointer points to this node, right? So this is one step, this is the second step, right? So what happens now? Finally, my fast pointer and slow pointer are pointing to the same node. Now, what this algorithm says here is, if your fast pointer and the slow pointer, both of them are pointing to the same node, Then we have a loop. That's what this algorithm says. You keep moving your fast pointer which is moving fast, which moves two steps in each iteration, and your slow pointer moves by one step, right? If your fast pointer and slow pointer point to the same node, except at the very beginning. At any other point, if they point to the same node, then we have a loop in our linked list. That's what this algorithm states. Okay, very simple. The way to determine that there is no loop. So this is the case when we have a loop. What is the case if we don't have a loop? The case that we don't have a loop here is, if the small pointer points to null, or if the fast pointer points to null, right? Or the fast pointer's next, right, is equal to null, right? Then, see, whenever we have these null values, imagine there is no loop here. Imagine there is no loop here and this is pointing to null. Then what happens here? Your fast pointer or slow pointer will eventually reach this node, right, whose next value is equal to null. So if any of these three conditions, if any of these conditions are satisfied, right, or in other words, if this is true and this is true and or any of these things are true, if any of these things are true, then there is no loop, right, then there is no loop, right. So this is how you determine a loop. Now you might wonder, okay, this seems like a cool trick. This seems like a cool trick, but why does it work? Right? Actually, I've seen some candidates in interviews who tell me the solution. Okay? So, because they've studied about Floyd's algorithm, they know fast and slow pointers, or the fast pointer is called as a hare pointer, the slow pointer is called the tortoise pointer. Okay? They come up with the solution. Fairly impressed. Then, some really good interviewers, what they ask is this, okay, all this is good. How do you argue that this algorithm is correct? Okay. What is a guarantee? How do you prove the correctness, or how do you argue the correctness of this algorithm? This is where I have seen a lot of people fail. Right? Because people have learned this concept of fast and slow pointers. They'll come up with this solution in no time. But many of them get stuck when I ask them, how do you prove the correctness of this algorithm? Okay. That's an important part, right? Just writing some algorithm and arguing with some diagrams and examples is not sufficient. To be a good software engineer, you should be able to argue that, yes, what I've written is a correct algorithm. How do you argue the correctness of this algorithm? Right? That's a very, very important question. And this is slightly on the advanced part. Proving the correctness is non-trivial. Okay, while this algorithm, see, this whole algorithm or this whole code can be written in like a few lines of code. Okay, the whole Floyd cycle detection algorithm, if you have a linked list, a singly linked list, writing the Floyd cycle detection algorithm is like 5 to 6 lines of code, depending on the programming language you are using. But proving correctness is non-trivial, and it's a more interesting puzzle or a problem, even in programming interviews. So let's argue two ways of doing it. Okay. So one way is the intuitive understanding. One way is the intuitive argument. The other is a more mathematical argument. The intuitive argument is this. If you look at the fast pointer and the slow pointer, okay, if you look at the world from the see, I believe you learned about relative velocities, right? I hope you learned about relative velocities in your 11th and 12th class in physics. Okay, let's assume this is moving at 10 kilometers per hour. Okay, let's assume you have two vehicles. One is S, the other is F, right? Let's assume vehicle S, okay, our car S is moving at 10 kilometers per hour, while car F is moving at 20 kilometers per hour, both in the same direction. Now, what is the relative velocity of F with respect to S? Because both of them are moving in the same direction, the relative velocity of F with respect to S is 10 kilometers per hour, right, which is 20 minus 10. So, we can use the same concept of relative velocities here. Look at this. Your S is moving at one unit or one step per iteration, right? It is moving at one step per iteration, while your F is moving at two steps per iteration. Okay, two steps per iteration. Now, relatively speaking, what is the relative velocity? Relative velocity of F with respect to, I'll write it in short form, with respect to S. Like if you think about it from S perspective, F is moving at one step per iteration, relatively speaking. Right? If you think about it from the frame of reference, right? Again, I'm using some physics terminology here. If you look at it from the perspective of S, F is moving at one step per iteration. Right? Now, if you think about it, if you have a loop like this, look at this. Let's say, again, I'm not drawing this whole squares, etc. Right? Let's assume this is the linear part of my linked list and this is the loop part of my linked list. Let's say, okay, this diagram is easier. My S and F both start here. My S and F both start here. Right? My S keeps moving slowly, my F moves faster. At some point, my S will reach here. Right? By the time my S reaches here, my F could be anywhere. Right? My F might have made multiple rotations also here. That's possible, right? But from now on, because they both are part of the loop now, let's assume everything moves in clockwise direction. Let's assume all the pointers are in clockwise direction. Right? Now, since both of them are in a cycle, both of them will move in this cycle. What is the relative speed of F with respect to S? the relative speed of f with respect to s, if you look at it from the frame of reference of s, the relative velocity of f is one step per iteration, right? Which means if you think of s to be static, okay, then f is moving at one step per iteration, which means eventually f and s have to coincide with each other, right? F and see, eventually both of them have to coincide with each other, because with respect to the frame of reference of s, if you think of s to be static, see, if I'm sitting in this car s, what will I see f to be speeding at, right? Think of them as two cars going in a loop, right? If I'm sitting in this car, I'll keep looking at f as if it's moving at one step per iteration, right? Which means eventually this will come and catch up with me, right? Wherever I am, because this whole thing is a loop. Think of these two as two cars that are running in a loop, right? This is one intuitive argument that you can make using the concept of relative velocities in physics, right? This is one way of arguing about it. The second argument is more rigorous, okay? More mathematical argument, okay? Again, in my own interviewing experience, I've seen candidates from different backgrounds, and I've seen physicists or people with physics backgrounds give these very nice intuitive explanations in some cases, right? The mathematical argument is more simple, okay? And again, it's also intuitive. So let's assume I have this loop like this, okay? Again, this is not trivial. Let's assume the length of this part is m, okay? Let's assume the length of this part is m, right? And of course, m is greater than or equal to 0, and m is an integer. Similarly, the length of this loop, let's assume the loop length is n, and n is also strictly greater than 0. Only then there is a loop, right? Okay, the length of this loop is n, and n is strictly greater than 0. Otherwise, there is no loop. And let's assume, after all these iterations, after using our slow and fast approach, right? After using our slow and fast approach, let's assume they both meet at some node k, and everything moves in clockwise direction. Remember that everything moves in clockwise direction, and k is the meeting position of both your fast and slow pointers. Then, let's assume I have finished I iterations till now. Okay, I don't know what I is. Now, in I iterations, okay, because look at this. My S and my F started here, and eventually they both reached this location, right? Let's look at it from the perspective of S, okay? S would have cleared all of these M nodes, right? So S would have cleared these M nodes plus S could have revolved around this loop also. See, this loop is of length N. Right, S, the slow pointer, could have moved around this loop some number of times. Okay, so let's say it ran that loop P times. Okay, so P into N is the total number of steps that it has taken. And finally, it has arrived at position K. So this is the number of steps. This is the number of steps at the end of I iterations. Right, again, at the end of some iterations, by the time they meet here, by the time my slow pointer and my fast pointer meet here, let's assume that my slow pointer, which started here, cleared all of these m steps. Then it went through this whole loop p times. So p is basically number of cycles or number of loops that it has finished. Right? It has finished all of them. And since the loop length is n, p into n plus k. Because it has now reached k where everything is meeting. Now if you look at it from the fast pointer's perspective, right? The fast pointer also started here, right? The fast pointer also covered these M nodes. Then, let's assume the fast pointer performed Q, the cycle, this loop it cleared Q times. Right? Let's assume it cleared this loop Q times. Again, remember that P is greater than or equal to 0 and Q is also greater than or equal to 0. But they're integers. Right? That's important fact here. Plus K. Right? Now, one thing that you have to notice here is that because the fast pointer is going to move at double the speed of the slow pointer, right, this into 2 should be equal to this. So, let's write it down. 2 into m plus pn plus k should be equal to m plus qn plus k. Right, that's what it is. Now, if you simplify both sides, 2m minus m, this will become m. 2k minus k, so this will become plus k here. This is equal to q minus 2p into n. Right? If I simplify it mathematically, and remember here that n is strictly greater than 0, m is greater than equal to 0, p is greater than equal to 0, and q is greater than equal to 0. Now, given a linked list like this, we already have, see, we don't know the exact values of m and n, but m and n are properties of the linked list. Okay, now what I have to prove, look at this, what I have to prove here, right, what I have to prove here is, there exists, see, to prove that they both will meet at k, right, I have to prove that given some m which is greater than or equal to 0 and some n which is strictly greater than 0, assuming that these are properties of the linked list itself, I have to prove that there exists P, Q and K, right? I have to prove that there exists P, Q, K. Again, remember that K is also greater than or equal to 0 and K is less than N. Okay, remember that K is less than N, right? Because there are only N nodes here. Okay, so there exists P, Q, 0 where P is greater than or equal to 0, Q is greater than or equal to 0, K is greater than or equal to 0 and K is less than N. So, if there exists some P, Q, K which satisfies this equation for any possible value of M and N, okay, then I've proved that these two pointers will match at some node called K. Okay, this is what I have to prove. I have to prove that there exists P, Q, K which satisfy this equation. That's what I have to prove. Right? This is a tricky thing to prove, non-trivial, mathematically speaking. But let's go to cases. Okay, there are two cases in this. Okay, case 1. Let's take two cases here, right? Case 1 is n is greater than m. This is case 1. I'll also write case 2 here. Okay, so case 2 will be, case 2 here is n is less than m. And what are n and m? N is nothing but the length of the loop. M is the length of this tail of the loop, this part, the straight part of which is not part of the loop itself, right? Now, let's take this case 1. What do we have to prove? What we have to prove is this. There exists some integers P, Q, K where P is greater than 0, Q is greater than 0, K is greater than or equal to 0 and K is less than N such that this equation is satisfied. Can I find P, Q, K which satisfy this? So let's try that. Okay. So let's assume P equals to 0. What if I can take P equals to 0, right? What does P equal to 0 mean? P equal to 0 means my slow pointer has not finished even a single loop. Perfectly valid. What's wrong with it? Okay, so if I take P equals to 0 and if I take Q equals to 1, look at what I have to prove. Okay, look at what I have to prove. I have to prove M plus K equals to Q minus 2P into N. This is what I have to prove. So if I make P equals to 0, this will become 0. If I make Q equals to 1, this is 1. Okay, then look at this. If I take these two values, okay, again, these have to be integers, right? That's why I'm taking the smallest value possible here, smallest value possible here. If I make Q equals to 0, this whole RHS becomes 0. I don't want that. Right? Now look at this. I know that N is greater than M. The case, what is this case? N is greater than M. Which means now I can choose my K equals to N minus M. So remember that N and M are integers and N is greater than M. What does this imply? This implies N minus M is greater than or equal to 0. What is the property of K? Remember, what is the property that K has to satisfy? K has to be greater than or equal to 0 and K is less than N, which is true, right? If N is greater than M and if K equals to N minus M, it satisfies both those conditions. P is greater than or equal to 0, this is satisfying. Q is greater than or equal to 0, it satisfies. Which means there exists, all I have to prove is there exists P, Q and K which satisfy this equation. Yes, they do satisfy this equation, right? Plug all of these values, right? M plus, what is K? K is N minus M, right? Equals to N. Yes, M cancels, N equals to N. So, when N is greater than or equal to M, it's very trivial to find P, Q, K. Very good. Okay. What is the second possible case? Second possible case is if N is less than M. Then let's see what happens. Okay. Or in other words, this can be written as M minus N is greater than 0. Okay, in this case, let's see what happens. If I pick P equals to 0, what is the equation that I have to satisfy? M plus K equals to Q minus 2P into N. So, here also I'll make P equals to 0. So, this is gone. So what am I left with? M plus k. Look at this. I'm left with m plus k equals to qn. This is what I'm left with, right? Now I have to find some value for q and some value for k. Now look at this. Don't forget the fact that n and m are integers, right? And n is less, see, n is less than m. Let's take some simple numeric values here. Okay. Let's assume n is equal to, let's say n equals to 2. We said n is less than m, right? If m is equal to 3. Okay. Then start. Now let's pick some number here. Okay. See, look at this. This is an integer. This is also an integer. So if I pick q equals to 1, what happens? It won't work out because the LHS is already 3. On the RHS also, I have only 2. This will never work out. On the other hand, if I pick q equals to 2, look at this. If I pick q equals to 2, this whole thing becomes 4. This is 3 and this is equal to 1. So for any integers of m and n, where m is greater than n, right? Whenever m is greater than n, pick any integers. I can find a value of q and k, okay, which satisfy this equation. Okay, because qn is basically a multiple of n. See, we are given that n, see, n is less than m. But there will be some multiple of n which will make it greater than m, or at least greater than equal to m. There will be some multiple, right? Because q is an integer here. Right? Remember that q is greater than or equal to 0. Right? So I can pick any q here. I can pick any q here. Q can even be 1000. I'll keep increasing the value of q. I'll keep increasing the value of q till the time this equation is satisfied. Now, once this equation is satisfied, my k is nothing but qn minus m. And since all of them, remember the key here is n is an integer, m is an integer, q is an integer. Okay, that's the key idea here. Right? And n is less than m. So, for any set of integers, for any values of m and n, where m is greater than n, we can find values of k and q that satisfy this very easily. Right? So, since for both cases, we have proven that there exists p, q, k which satisfy these conditions, which also satisfy this equation. Hence, what does this whole thing tell us? This whole thing tells us that yes, if I follow this logic where the fast pointer moves 2 steps and the slow pointer moves by 1 step, eventually I'll hit a node here. I'll hit a node k. There exists a node k. Okay, and there exists p and q. There exists p and q. P is the number of times the slow pointer has finished the loop. Q is the number of times the slow pointer has finished the loop. Okay, there exists p, q, k such that fast and slow pointer meet here. This is a more mathematical way of proving it. Now remember, in both these cases, there is a very interesting observation. I don't know if you have made that observation or not. In both these cases, my p equals to 0. In both these cases, I can pick p equals to 0 and still get valid values for k and q. Even in this case, I'm picking p equals to 0 and I can get valid values for q and k. Which means, in reality, my slow pointer need not even finish one whole loop. Okay, p equals to 0 basically means what? P equals to 0 implies that my slow pointer hasn't finished one loop yet. So, using this slow pointer and fast pointer approach, what's happening here is, my slow pointer will finish m, and my slow pointer will go through this loop, and before it finishes this loop once, my fast pointer will come and catch up with it at some node k, right? Which means, what is the total time complexity of this approach now? What is the total time complexity of this approach now? Again, proving the time complexity of this approach is very important, and you can prove it using this mathematical argument. Because my slow pointer is moving through all these values and all these values at most once. Look at this. P equals to 0. What is the maximum value of k? Maximum value of k is n. Which means what is the total time complexity? M plus n. Or in other words, I've already used all the variable names. It's order of n, where n is the total number of nodes. Okay, again, here this n is not the number of nodes in the loop. Or let's write it as capital N. Okay. It's order of N, where N is, in this case, N is M plus N. Okay. What is the space complexity here? I'm only using two pointers, right? So, it's order of 1. I'm only using a slow pointer and a fast pointer. That's all I'm using, right? So for this problem, while the Floyd's cycle detection algorithm is very, very simple, proving the correctness of this algorithm is more interesting. And there are two ways of proving it. One is the intuitive way using relative velocities. The other is a more rigorous mathematical approach where you actually put in these numbers and you argue that there exists P, Q, K that satisfy this equation. Okay. And again, this is the fun part. If you go to an interview, some interviewers might just accept your fast and slow algorithm. The more rigorous interviewers, especially at top-notch companies, will ask you, how do you prove the correctness of this algorithm? How do you argue that this algorithm that you're claiming is correct is actually correct rigorously? Okay, now let's look at again, the code for this is very, very straightforward. Okay, here is a code snippet for it. I'll share a link for this whole code snippet, which you can run in an online compiler. Okay, again, this function is called detect loop. It takes the head pointer. It returns an integer. It returns 1. If there is a loop, it returns 0 otherwise. Okay, here I'm creating 2 pointers, fast pointer and slow pointer. Look at this for loop. This for loop, I'm initializing the fast pointer and slow pointer to head, right? So this is my initialization. This is my termination condition, and I don't have a update. I don't have any update here. So it doesn't have any update. What is my termination condition? If fast pointer is null, or slow pointer is null, or fast pointer next is null, it will terminate. If any of them is null, this whole thing will terminate. Right? And what is it saying? Fast pointer equals to fast pointer next, which means it is making 2 steps here. Slow pointer equals to slow pointer next, which means slow pointer is making 1 step. If fast pointer equals to slow pointer, return 1. Right? Otherwise, at the end of this for loop, you have encountered a null pointer somewhere. Hence, you terminate this loop and you return 0, stating that there is actually no loop in this. That's all. See, I told you, right? This whole algorithm can be written in literally 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 lines of code, even in C programming language. Again, we could have shrunk this to fewer lines by writing much more succinct code. Okay, but we wanted to write more easy to read code. That's why it's 6 lines. So this program or this function is very, very simple and elegant. The core idea, the challenge here is to recognize that this problem can be solved using the fast and slow pointers of Floyd cycle detection algorithm. A more interesting aspect is, how do you prove and argue the correctness of this algorithm? That's the more fun part.